Hello and welcome to episode 66 of the Critical Twits Gaming Podcast. We're back on the Netrunner this week, where we'll be taking you through a beginner's guide to the Jinteki Corporation. And welcome back. I'm Brian Ennis.
And I'm Joe Lewin.
And today we're going to be running the nets once more. And we're going to be taking a look at the Jinteki Corporation from a beginning player's point of view, explaining what it is, what the key cards are, and its key strategies as part of our sort of new set of features.
Yeah. It's something that we've, as a group, mostly stuck to the Corps and the Runners factions that we like.
Yes, yeah.
So this is going to be a good experience for us in branching out into new things.
Yeah, definitely.
And also a nice way for other people, if you're just getting into Netrunner or you're thinking about a faction change because you've been playing NBN the whole time because yellow dominates everything.
Yeah.
And you realise that, at least in my opinion, it's not at the top anymore. What else do you play? How do you do it? Where's the best place to start?
Yes.
Hopefully we can answer some of those questions.
Yeah, so it gives us an opportunity to sort of learn along with you as well. Because we started off with our Netrunner Noobs. The challenge was for myself and Aaron under Jamie and Joe's slightly more experienced tutelage to move into the world of competitive play, which I won. Take that, Aaron. He's so sad he's not here today. He's just crying under a bridge.
Yep.
Makes him a troll if he's crying under a bridge.
Yes.
Yes. Good. one of the things I found clicked fairly early on with Netrunner, I think I've been playing a couple months and I've been playing Wayland and I've been playing Noise.
Mm-hmm.
I've been playing my Argus deck, and my Noise deck, Wayland and Anarchs, is we went to the charity gift tournament and I had to learn a couple new IDs because that forced me to. I didn't get to pick my IDs for that tournament. And then I came up against a Wayland deck. Now, this went really badly for me.
This is one of my favourite stories.
Because I died horribly to it out of sheer idiocy, leaving myself tagged against Argus.
What ID was it? It was against Argus.
Yeah,
ID you had been solely playing.
I'd played about 55 games with Argus at that point, because we were keeping track, we were keeping score.
Yeah.
But I got overconfident because I thought I knew what I was doing.
Yes.
My new idea. Every time I've played Argus since that time, and I've played Argus 5 or 6 times, various people have been playing it, I've won every single game because I know what it does. So bar that one minor blip, actually moving through the factions, moving through the IDs and playing different ways of playing, different styles, different types of deck is a really good way to learn the game, because Netrunner is quite a complex game.
Yeah, because you mostly started off with Wayland Anarch, or more specifically Argus Noise.
Yeah.
I started off mostly playing NBN because I love the background and the idea of the Corp. I moved away from it due to it being in top position and wanting to branch out a little bit.
Yeah.
And runner-wise, I've always liked Criminals, but I started off playing with Apex.
Yes.
Primarily.
You can see my Argus playing Joe's Apex on the internet at the link that will just appear now, probably, if you're on YouTube, and I remember.
And if not, go on YouTube and find it.
Yeah.
It's been great. I found branching out helpful because you start looking at entirely different card pools. You don't have to read other people's cards quite as much.
Yes, yeah. Which, as we learnt last month, is unprofessional.
It is, yes.
Makes you seem like a scrub.
Yes, Mark. we're going to start off today talking about Jinteki, the corporation.
Yes. So we're going to go through who are they, what are they, how do they play, how are they unique, because each faction in Netrunner is unique in its own way.
Yeah, they all have things that they do specifically.
Yeah, things that they do best, because you can always import cards via the influence system.
Yes.
But there'll always be an advantage to use to having certain styles of play inside certain factions. And then we're going to talk to you about, I said our first game night kit earlier. It's actually my first game night kit.
Well, it technically wasn't even a game night kit.
Was it not?
No, it's the quarter one kit.
Okay, what's that then, Joe?
It's like a game night kit, but it's called a quarter one kit.
Okay.
I'm not... If I'm honest, I'm not entirely sure. Fantasy Flight have published this as the quarter one kit.
Yeah.
And they do a quarter one kit for all of the competitive games they do. So there was also a Game of Thrones quarter one kit, for example. And then the game night kits are little in-between ones, okay. I guess.
But yeah, but whatever it was, we went along to it, up to our friendly local gaming store, the Hobbit Hole in Chatteris.
Yes.
And played a bit of, I wouldn't say like hardcore competitive Netrunner, but it was still competitive, but it didn't have the kind of taking a cut at the end and playing out.
No, it's designed
elimination and things
as,
like that.
I can't remember the format, but you play three rounds and it's all based on that.
Yeah, yeah. So we'll tell you a little bit about how that went as well at the end.
Yes.
So, Jinteki. Now, I have a particular reason for starting us off on Jinteki. It's something you said on Saturday while we were playing. First of all, at our game night kit, there were actually three people playing Jinteki out of six.
Three out of six, and I was surprised it wasn't four.
Yeah.
Because I thought Carl was going to bring Jinteki as well.
Yeah, he'd been playing quite a bit of Jinteki, but he went with...
HB,
yes. He went with Cybernetics.
He did.
I'm so glad I didn't have to play against that.
It got me down to hand size one.
Mm.
Yeah.
Did it beat you?
No, Leela is OP.
So we saw quite a lot of Jinteki. We were talking about that in a smoke break in between games, and you said that you thought that Jinteki was currently top of the pile.
I do think so. I'm sure far better players than me might disagree. But if you look at what's out, what's available, and the counters available to each thing... NBN still has a bit of has ways of tagging you far more than anything else.
Yeah.
Wayland can do the same thing now because of the ridiculous amount of money it can pull in.
Yeah.
But I don't think tagging strategies are king currently.
Because of
things like Aaron on the Lamb, and I wouldn't be surprised to see paper tripping popping up a little bit more as well to clear a horrible mid-season's turn.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I think Jinteki's in a very good position. I think it's getting lots of really nice tricks. It's building on things it does well already with some of the new cards in Daedalus Complex.
Yep.
And, yeah, I'm dead excited for the new ID coming up soon as well. Because it's more, I think they're a little bit more of a finesse faction, because you're relying on tricks far more than you're relying on just the brute strength of your ice like you would in HB or something like that.
Yeah, cool. So let's start at the right back at the beginning then. What is the Jinteki Corporation? What do they do?
This is always a question I answer wrong, because at some point in my
evolution.
There's been, what, eight or so months we've all been playing properly competitively?
Yes, yeah.
But I've had the core set for a couple of years. And my brain gets obsessed with them making AIs, because there are some cards that say, like, you've got, like, fetal AI and stuff like
yes,
that.
Yes, yeah.
But that's not what they do.
No. What they do is they are a biotechnical corporation specialising in cloning.
Yes.
So genetic manipulation, cloning, meat stuff. If you think of AIs and bioroids in the HB sense as being hardware, you'd probably take Jinteki as being sort of wetware, as they term it. It's a proper cyberpunk term.
I feel dumb.
I feel like I need to prove this to you now.
Do you?
Yeah.
It's just, still going to sound dumb.
It probably will. There you go, yeah. Wetware, human brain cells or thought processes. So it's manipulating the human body the bodies of other creatures and such like.
I would argue that Jinteki also do a lot of foodstuffs, not yes. just in the meat sort of thing. But again, that is your cloning and your genetic manipulation.
Yeah, yeah.
Because, you know, I don't think GM foods are actually all that bad.
No. The Global Food Initiative could almost have been a Jinteki card.
It could have.
And it would have fit perfectly with what they do. They have Pilada foodstuffs as an ID that you can play.
You've got either a recently released or an upcoming card. You've got, like, replanting.
Yeah.
Yeah, they have a lot of things in that kind of area.
Yes. Now, they are, as the name maybe suggests, they are a Japanese corporation.
Yes.
Although they have moved their operation to New Angeles, their HQ, for the tax breaks that it gives.
They just wanted to be in the board game.
Yeah, Cyberpunk can be weird sometimes. You're like, yes, this big evil corporation is taking a tax break over here. It's not like Thugnar the Barbarian went there to save the princess.
No.
It has weird plot points sometimes. and they have... they are an old-fashioned, conservative, quite slow-moving corporation who have just had, in the background, Chairman Hero. Is it Hero?
Yes.
Cool. I should have said, just gone with it and sounded more...
Do you want to try again?
Confident. No, we'll leave it in because it might be funny.
Okay.
Chairman Hero. He is like a new upcoming younger guy who's kind of trying to push them and develop them. And the way that manifests itself in their gameplay style is that they find it incredibly upsetting that you would dare to try to hack them. And their big thing is from the core set onwards was doing you net damage.
Yes.
So they would... Wayland, if you really annoy them, they will tag you. They'll find out where you live. They'll send someone around to shoot your mum.
Possibly kick your dog.
Yeah. HB will sort of slowly brain damage you.
Yeah.
If you keep making mistakes against them. MBN, they will ruin your life. They will take your money away.
Yeah, exactly.
They will. Yeah, they'll tell your mum what you really did last week, and then she'll be upset with you. Whereas Jinteki are all about stopping you via net damage, so feeding impulses back through the net to damage you and your equipment, and sort of force you to bugger off, basically. And that's something that they've done quite well from the beginning.
They have all... Each faction has had the thing it does.
Yeah.
And Jinteki, yeah, like you say, Wayland is meat damage, HB is brain, Jinteki is net, and MBN tags.
Yes.
So, yeah, they're... it's one of the... Meat damage is the easiest to avoid. Net damage is probably... Oh, see, I don't know. I don't know whether I'd argue it's the hardest.
There's a brain damage is the hardest, I've always found.
But it's... I think that's now changed.
Yeah, I would say... Because there are a few hard counters. We're maybe jumping ahead slightly. And you can play a Jinteki deck that does no net damage. Because we're at the point now where...
Yeah.
There's so many cards per...
Well, you can play a Jinteki deck that it's not your main... thing. You could play one that doesn't do net damage, but you would be deliberately not including cards that have net damage on.
Yeah.
Because a lot of their ice does it. So.
Yeah. Rich Shapers might be able to install a feedback filter.
Yep.
It's very expensive.
Or a net shield.
Yeah, I'll just look it up, net shield, actually, because I don't think I've ever seen one in the wild. Net shield, a bit cheaper, but only does the first net damage.
Yeah.
Whereas the feedback filter is 3 credits per net damage, but you can, in theory, do an infinite number of that.
Yeah.
As long as you've got an infinite number of credits.
Or you have... you've always got Guru Devinda, who can do 4 credits...
Yes.
...to stay on the board after preventing any amount of net damage.
Yeah.
So now, that's kind of cool.
The thing I quite like is that... Because there's counters to the other types of damage as well.
Yep.
Meat damage has Plascrete and other things.
Yeah.
So damage can be avoided. But Wayland needs to find where you live to do meat damage.
It does.
Generally against HB, you need to do something wrong to take that brain damage, because it's quite hard to get it to stick, because it is so powerful and it kind of lasts forever.
Yeah, it's the easiest to avoid. Yeah.
Whereas Jinteki will have lots and lots of things that will do net damage.
Yeah.
They have ice that can directly damage. They'll have assets they can advance that can directly damage. They'll have traps that can damage you. So they have lots of ways of getting this
assets you across. Don't need to advance that just directly damage you. Yeah, it's a horrible state of affairs sometimes.
Because one of the things I said that appealed to me when we started playing Netrunner, and I was like, I want to be Argus. I want to find out where they live and shoot them in the face.
Yeah.
I want to hurt them, which maybe makes me sound like a psychopath. But it fits that Netrunner thing of, you know, being the evil corporation that murders people. It's very
cyberpunk.
Yes. Whereas actually, I think maybe Jinteki would have been a better place for me to start, because it is the most directly aggressive faction I have found. It has the most things where you don't have to tag them to then scorched earth them. You don't have to get them to run that server so you can flip your upgrade and land a brain damage.
There are less steps involved in applying the damage to
you. You can advance a Ronin, flip it over, click it, do 3 net damage.
Yeah.
Hooray! I just damaged you. You can play a Neural EMP out of hand and do a point of damage. Try and snipe that card that they just spent ages drawing for.
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting thing, because it's always in small amounts, though.
Yes, yeah, it doesn't let you do lots and
you
lots
don't,
all
you don't have the Wayland thing of going, boom, I do you 7 damage.
Yes,
which
that's
will kill pretty much any unprotected runner.
Yeah, if you're not prepared for that, you're dead.
Yeah.
The other thing that they do is psi games.
Yes.
Which I find quite interesting, because again, when we started this podcast, I was saying how I like the interaction, the bluffing and such like that's involved in Netrunner. You don't get that in many other card games.
No. Not many things play with stuff face down.
Yes.
Like Yu-Gi-Oh, maybe.
Does it?
Yeah.
I've never played Yu-Gi-Oh.
You can play your cards face down in the field. Yeah.
I place my trap card face down.
Yes.
So those are where, under certain conditions, the runner and the corp will spend 0, 1, or 2 credits.
Yep.
And generally, you want to be spending, as Jinteki, you want the two of you to spend different amounts that will make something terrible happen.
Yeah. They're always, it's all pretty much always worded, and then do this if you and the runner spent a different number of credits.
Yeah.
So you can engineer situations where that's going to happen.
Yes, definitely. But if the runner has no credits or just 1 credit, then you can always pay your 2 to guarantee it.
Now, there is a card that counters psi games.
Yes.
That no one ever uses.
No.
Because they're a pain, but they're not perfect.
Yeah.
Because there is always that chance that someone will just know guess what you put down and ruin your fun.
Yeah.
But it is definitely a big part of the faction. They are the only faction you can find psi games in.
Yeah. And obviously other people can import psi games in.
Yes.
And there's a couple cards that we'll talk about later that I've used outside of Jinteki.
Yep.
Because of their psi game awesomeness. That card, you probably don't see it a lot, because if you're not playing Jinteki, it's 9 times out of 10, they're
worthless.
Not going to. Yeah, you're not going to see it, and it's a wasted slot in your deck. So that's kind of their strengths, is doing the net damage and having these psi games, because some of the abilities are quite powerful on the psi games.
Yeah,
but that's because there's a chance, if you just take it at pure randomness, a 1 in 3 chance that they're not going to fire at all.
Yeah.
But each faction also has its drawbacks.
Yes.
So what are the drawbacks for Jinteki, Joe?
Jinteki don't have many consistent economy cards.
Yeah.
They have quite a lot of cards that make them money, but there's normally some kind of prerequisite for that money.
Yeah, there's some kind of...
Or a trade-off in some way.
Yeah, one of the things they do, and this is, I think this is something that has developed beyond Core as we've moved sort of through the expansions and the data packs and the cycles, is that quite often as Jinteki, you'll be able to give yourself a nice advantage, but you'll also give something to the runner.
Yes.
And I think this is the idea that actually... Although they murder you when you break in, they're not necessarily the nastiest corporation because a lot of their things benefit mankind. Yeah, so you have something like a mental health clinic that will give you money each turn, but it increases the runner's hand size by one.
Yes.
Because they could be a customer of said mental health clinic. Yeah. They have a medical research fundraiser.
Yep.
Which gives you... you only need to spend three...
And it gives you the same amount of money that Restructure does.
Yeah,
and
plus you need five credits.
You need 10 for that to do Restructure.
It's a really good way of digging your Jinteki out of a hole if you've been forced to rest some ice or advance something that you thought, oh, actually, they're going to grab that quick. And you've got yourself into... Because going bust in Netrunner is really bad. It can often take you a few turns to dig your way out of that really zero.
Well, I mean, if you look at worst case scenario, so... Any other faction would need to claw their way out. If you've got a money card in hand, you've got a hedge fund, you need five credits to trigger it.
Yeah.
If you've got a restructure, you need 10. As the two generics, you've got the little things like Wayland's.
Beanstalk royalties.
Yeah. NBN sweep tweaks, that kind of stuff. But to be able to go, cool, well, I'll click for three credits and then next turn go straight to eight at the beginning. Yeah. It's a really nice boost. But, as with most of these things, again, it has a downside in that the runner also gains three credits.
Yeah, and there's quite a few of these cards that they have that are good for them, but you're also giving something to the runner, which I like. I quite like that.
The other way they do things is that in certain decks, a very good economy card would be... Sundew.
Yeah.
Because you gain the money at the start of the runner's turn. Well, when the runner first spends a click, if they don't run at the server the Sundew is installed in, you gain two credits.
Yeah.
So that's got a prerequisite to get the money, but you're not giving the runner anything apart from a choice.
Yeah. Yeah, they could quite easily be... just run it, kill it, and it's cost you... Well, it's cost them nothing, essentially. They've trashed an asset.
Cost them a click.
Yeah.
And a click can be worth anything up to 7 credits if you're a criminal.
Yeah, potentially. Now, so they tend to suffer slightly in the economy stakes.
Yep.
They also... they tend to have... Not fairly weak ice, but the ice that they have...
Very porous ice.
Yeah, the ice they have, you can get through their ice. Yeah. It may cost you a few cards in net damage to get in, but they have very few big end-the-run ice, or strong end-the-run ice. They have a couple.
Yeah.
They don't have really, apart from the data pack just released, many... low strength end the run ice as well. You don't have things like an ice wall that you can chuck down,
news hound, or anything like that that can be a real early score behind type ice.
Yes.
No, they are. They do, and even the new one, or even any of the ones they do, they're all 4 or 5 credits. They're not cheap.
Yes. Yeah. So they lack those sort of those stronger ice, and instead they're almost saying, if you are going to be so dishonourable as to come into our servers, we will hurt you, but we can't stop you. Yeah, so they have a punishment and correction style. They're more like a stern father figure, slapping your hand as a naughty, impudent runner for daring to sort of access their secrets. Which I quite like. I quite like that.
It's a nice theme, definitely. And I like the fact that it's been adhered to strongly throughout the lifespan of Netrunner so far.
Yeah.
I'm very interested to see where it goes.
Yeah,
because there's... everyone's escalating slightly nowadays.
Yes.
With the move to Mars. Do you just up the net damage numbers? Or do they go in a slightly different direction?
Yeah. There's one of the more recent cards. Again, we're jumping around slightly. One of the new cards that they've just released in Daedalus Complex is Kakugo, which is a barrier, cost 4. It's only strength 1, and it has an end the run. So we get quite an expensive ice, but the ability of it, when the runner passes Kakugo, do 1 net damage. I really like that.
Yes.
Because normally you're paying to break the ice to stop yourself taking damage. Now you've got a choice.
Mm-hmm.
You can take that net damage, or you can get bounced out of the server.
Yeah.
And I like that. I really like that particular ice.
Just that's it's a very Jinteki thing.
Yes.
Giving the runner a choice.
Mm.
Do you want to let me keep getting money and enjoy an additional hand size?
Yes.
You know, do you want to let me have some money, or do you want to waste your first kick running on this server? And then things like the research fundraiser. You give yourself the question, do I want some money if they get some too?
Yeah. Yeah, I find Jinteki, playing Jinteki and playing against Jinteki, exercises my brain possibly the most.
Yes, I would say so.
Because there's all these choices.
Mm-hmm.
Do you do this? Do you do that? You've kind of got, quite often you'll be, the runner will be placed in a situation where they have a bad decision or a really bad decision that they can make.
Yes.
One of the things that we're seeing more of, I think, and we might see, we've got a new one coming out in this cycle, is agendas that protect themselves.
So yes.
The old staple that will be rotating out soon is Fetal AI,
which is sad to see that go.
Which costs 2 credits and 2 net damage to steal. It's a 4-2.
It's a
5-2 agenda. Yes.
Yeah.
It almost becomes like a trap in and of itself, because you can sit there and advance that as the Jinteki player. Now, it might be a trap card that's going to do damage,
yeah,
but you might be on the cusp of scoring out. If you've got 5 points, they have to run it. Yeah. And even if they run it, they might take so much damage that next turn you can finish them off with something else.
Well,
an awkward choice, isn't it?
The thing with Fetal, and the reason it's a 5-2...
Yeah.
As one of the only 5-2s in the game?
Yeah, I know a 6-2. HB have 6-2.
But there's not many.
Yeah.
And it's because the net damage triggers on access.
Yeah.
So the moment they hit that card, they are taking 2 damage.
Yeah.
There is then an additional cost on top of that,
which
they have to pay 2 credits to steal it.
Yes.
Now that is, if you've not planned for it, if you know how much it costs to get in that server and you've gone, yes, I've got the 10 credits it's going to cost me to get in, and you're rewarded by saying, no, you can't have this because you haven't got any money left. Oh, and you lose a couple of cards.
Yeah.
Horrible situation.
Yes.
I mean, it's something that, obviously, as a good player, you plan for and you try and take into account. But even so, it's just mean.
Yes, very much so. You also have the Future Perfect.
Yes.
Which you, and if you access it while it's installed, you can just steal. But if you manage to dig it out of HQ, Archives, R&D, you have to play a Psy game for.
Yeah.
And that can be an incredibly annoying card to actually steal off of the Corp. I've been the runner a few times and just not been able to take the thing and win that Psy game.
Again, if you're really good at Psy games, you either don't care because you just go, cool, I reckon you'll spend this and get it right.
Yeah.
Or you might, it might just let your hand have 3 Future Perfects in and never lose one all game.
Yeah.
So they go, nah, it's not for you.
Yeah.
So it is interesting.
And again, as you said, with the Psy game, if you hit the server and you've spent all your money,
yep,
the court can go, oh, I'll pay one. You've got no money, you can't have it.
To stop you having 3 points.
Yeah.
Nearly half of your victory.
Yeah,
position.
And a game where you're trying to get to 7, 3 points can be huge.
Yeah.
And, yeah, no, you just deny it for a credit.
Yeah.
It can be very, very sort of cheeky in that way.
It's another one of their things they do that's frustrating.
Yes.
But I think the frustration with Jinteki comes from the fact that it's interactive.
Yes, yeah.
Because you are saying, make a choice. Every time, make a choice.
Yeah.
Now, there's all, you know, everything you do in Netrunner is making a choice of which card to play, what server to run, etc.
Yeah.
But Jinteki increases the consequences for getting that choice wrong.
Yeah.
And I think that's what makes it such an interesting faction to play as and against.
Yes, yeah. So let's just talk a little bit about the Jinteki personal evolution, the core set identity.
Yep, okay.
Because that's kind of the baseline for each faction has that baseline of what was in the core box. And if you're like us, if you're playing something new, maybe you've been sort of getting into this along with us, you may not have huge amounts of cards yet.
No,
it might be
no.
The first, your first taste of Jinteki will be playing with or against personal evolution.
Yeah.
I really like the ID. I think it's got weaker over time as more counters to damage have come in.
I think that the real counter to it has been far more recent. Stuff has come up that's like net shield and everything else could be seen as a counter to it, if not an expensive one. But I think the thing that really kicks in is Aaron. But then this has been discussed elsewhere and people know.
Yeah, Aaron, he lets you draw back up outside of your turn as the runner.
And the thing that gives him counters is the same thing that triggers the ID.
Yeah,
and
that's, so he is quite almost like a hard counter to that. But I still, it's what I've been playing. It's what I took along to the game night kit. And I've been really enjoying it. So doing that net point of net damage when you score or your opponent steals an agenda.
Yep.
Which is lovely with a fetal AI because it's suddenly doing 3 damage, not 2.
Yep.
For instance. And it lets you, it gives you a kind of death by a thousand cuts style.
Yeah, like before, you're not doing big chunks of damage.
Yeah.
So you are slowly but surely whittling them down, making them spend money, or well, time, and time is money, on getting cards back into their hand so they can survive another run through some agendas.
Yeah.
I think it's an extra layer of things to think about.
Yeah. I think one of the cards that has actually hurt Jinteki the most is Levy AR Access. Lab Access. AR Lab Access? Is Levy. There you go. The card, the shaper card that lets you put your heap back, shuffle all your cards back and start again. Because it doubles the timer before the runner runs out of cards. Because quite often, if you're doing these little niggly bits of damage and forcing them to draw back up, eventually they're going to run out of cards. They can't draw up. Their hit point pool, their goes cards away. In hand, goes away. That's much harder to do these days.
It is, but I don't know. I don't see it as, I suppose when you're trying to do it bit by bit and slowly whittle them down over a few turns.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it does. Especially with cards like Quality Time and Diesel and stuff as well that allow you to draw a bit quicker.
Yeah.
So, and the fact it replaces your hand as well is quite good. You play Levy and you discard your hand.
Yeah.
Of potentially nothing at this point because you've run out of everything.
Yeah.
But you get to draw 5 back up.
Yes.
So yeah, it's a good card to use, but it's weirdly that it's not an auto include because a lot of runner decks don't go through their entire deck in a game.
No. But it can be, if you know they've not got a levy, sometimes it's fine to fire off some of the cards that will do damage, because you know that you're reducing what they can use and getting them closer to that point where they're kind of milled out.
You're putting them into more bad decisions because they haven't got the answers anymore.
Yes, whereas against things that are going to more than likely have a levy kicking about, you're kind of halving the impact of that. You're like, oh, well, I could get rid of three of their cards with my Ronin, but actually, I'm going to save that to try and kill them because no point playing long.
Yeah, I suppose you're hoping to hit the levy.
Yes.
And take it away from them. But then with things like same old thing now being a factor, you've got to try and take those away as well. And it becomes problematic if your intention is to mill the runner out across the game.
Yeah.
Definitely.
So that first ID has that... it really doubles down on that. Okay, you can attack us, but you're not going to like it.
Yeah.
Because you go, hooray, I've stolen the agenda. It's a one-point agenda and I have to lose a card.
Mm-hmm.
Deep digs can become quite dangerous if you're using medium to take lots of cards out of R&D, for instance.
Oh, yeah, you need to run with at least as many cards in hand as agenda points you need.
Yeah.
But that then doesn't take into account snares, shocks, and other things.
Horrible things.
Yeah, really big medium runs are a scary prospect against Jinteki.
Yes. As is sometimes accessing multiple cards from HQ.
Yep.
And sometimes I really like shock, the card, which does one net damage when accessed.
Yes.
You have to pay to trash it.
Yeah.
The runner has to pay to trash it, and then it goes into archives and it still fires from archives. So if you get all three of your shocks in archives, you can make an archive run to, for whatever reason,
checking face down cards, seeing if you discard agendas, all sorts of things.
Yeah, suddenly cost you three net damage each time you do it, which can really slow the runner down.
Because that's normally I've got a spare click, I'll go check what's in there.
Yeah. Or even archives is a really cheeky Temujin target at the beginning of the game. Temujin contract. Probably being one of the best economy cards in the game.
Because it compresses your economy into running.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you're making a run and then you're gaining 4 credits each time for doing it. Giving you what, a net gain of 16 credits over 6 total clicks. It's almost 3 credits a click.
Net
and
gain.
You get to run and check stuff.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's something that I see lots and lots of.
Yes.
And have used a lot as well.
Yeah,
But it's something that gets splashed for outside of just criminals.
Because it's
really, really good.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, that core ID then, there's still some really good core Jinteki cards as well. From the basic box. Project Junebug.
Really good card.
Yeah, so it's a trap card. When accessed, you will do 2 net damage for each advancement token on the card.
Yep.
As long as you can pay a single credit. Really, really cheap. One credit to trigger a Junebug, yeah.
There have been a number of times I have run on servers with counters on going, it's only got a credit, that's fine.
Yeah,
because Snare is expensive.
Snare is one of the other cards I was going to say. But yeah, Snare costs 4 to do 3 net damage and a tag.
Oh, it's only 1.
It is, yeah. I think
I've been lucky not to get Junebugged in the face more often.
Yeah. A Project Junebug with a couple advances on is a handicap to the runner, but they will generally be running at you with lots of cards in hand.
Mm.
A Project Junebug with 3 advances on is suddenly a decision, because do they draw up if they don't have any other way of negating net damage? Do they want to lose all 6 of those cards as well, just in case? And what I've been doing quite a lot is having some nice 4 advanced Project Junebugs on the table, which suddenly will cost you 8 cards.
Yeah.
And can be an instant kill in most circumstances. Not in every circumstance.
You're into the realms of Wayland's meat damage levels. With
You're actually doing more damage than a boom. But they have to run it. They have to hit it.
They have. Yeah, yes. It's not just you've got two tags, so I'm going to do this. You have to set it up. Getting four tags on. Getting four advancement tokens on, you can't just do in a single turn.
Yeah.
Out of core, anyway.
Out of core, yes, you can. But nowadays, it's fairly straightforward to do so.
Well, more so, yeah.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I mean, it's just a...
It's a really good card. It still sees a lot of play. Snare, you often see splashed about. I've seen that splashed into Argus quite a lot. Because it will whittle their hand down and it will give them a tag.
I think that's the important thing in there.
Yeah, it's the tag extra. So if they hit that late or they hit that without realising, and that's doesn't need to be advanced. In fact, can't be advanced.
Mm.
So can be triggered from HQ, from R&D, or if you install it.
Yes.
Probably doesn't see a lot of installing, but sometimes.
Yeah, I mean, this is one of the things I like about Jinteki. They have two types of traps, and I think you pick something we discussed quite a lot early on. Is it a good idea to mix them? So, because I don't think so. I think you either are playing a deck that will advance agendas while they're on the field that will stay advanced across turns, or you are playing the type of deck that will try and get every advancement token onto a card during a single turn. So it plays lots of 3/2s and 3/1s.
Yeah.
So if you're doing that, and when you start advancing, you're going to finish advancing that turn and score it.
Yeah.
You don't really want June bugs because it becomes obvious.
Yeah, yeah.
Whereas if you are advancing your agendas and leaving them down, having installed cards that are face down that you're not advancing ever makes it look far more like a trap.
Yes. Yeah.
So pick with whatever style your deck is going in and try and go with that. I mean, although a mix could work and could throw people
off. Yeah, if you want to make R&D or HQ feel spiky, so to feel dangerous to go into...
Shocks and snares do fantastic work.
Yeah. Even if you're not necessarily then going to be advancing them. It's just whether you've got space for them.
But then if you've got...
installing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But the nice thing about some of them is that they can fire from HQ.
Yes, yeah.
Yeah.
Another, so we've got Project Junebug, Snare, Ronin. Yeah. Ronin is a key component of both of the decks that we've been playing. Well, you've been playing a couple Jinteki decks, actually, Joe.
But they've all got Ronin.
They've all got Ronin. Okay, yeah. So all three of the decks we've been playing have all had Ronin as a key component. Ronin's quite an unusual card. I think in the closest thing I can think of to the way it operates is the Wayland Contract Killer introduced in Blood Money.
Yes.
But he's kind of like a cheap, not quite so good version.
But
he's easier to use.
He has additional utility as well.
Yeah.
Because he doesn't just target the player, he can shoot out connections.
Yes, yeah. Whereas the Ronin is three straight net damage, but you have to advance the card four times and then spend a click and trash it to score that.
Yes.
So it's a five advance, or five click card, six click if you include installing it, I suppose.
Yeah, so six clicks for three net damage.
Yeah, is that efficient? It is if it kills them.
Well, yes. Now, that's the thing. Six clicks. So, and if you've not got any way of getting additional tokens onto the card, you are talking six clicks and four credits?
Yeah.
If you run a click at, what, credit and a half on average?
Yeah.
I'd say... It's quite expensive, money-wise.
It is. But if it wins you the game, then it's worth it.
Then it doesn't matter.
Yeah. And the proliferation of advanceable traps within Jinteki means that people can be...
It's more likely to survive, yeah.
Yeah. And I'll regale you with some stories of what happened to my brain when I first started playing Jinteki. when we get to the archetypes section. Now, those cards are still good now.
Yes, they are.
Along with Nisei Mark II, which is a core agenda.
Oh, so good.
It is. It's a 3-1.
No, it's a 4-2.
It's a 4-2. Cool.
If it was a 3-1, it'd be even better.
It'd be broken. Yeah, no, you're right. It's a 4-2. And it you get a counter when you score it. You can pay that counter to immediately end the run. Yeah. So that's so good.
Yeah.
Although you have to remember that you've scored it.
There's a counter on it.
And there's a counter on it.
And your timing's during a run to trigger it at the right time.
Yes.
Which is generally just before the run becomes successful.
Yeah. They get their successful run. They're about to access the agenda that you don't want them to take, and then you bang and you kick them back out, and they spent all their resources getting into the server, maybe lost some cards, taken some damage, and then they're booted straight back out. I love that card. I don't actually use that in my deck I've made because it's too slow.
It's in my deck that I'm going to start using soon for Jinteki that is actually trying to score. Isn't trying to kill.
Oh,
I know.
Disgraceful behaviour. That is one thing that, because the ice is porous, Jinteki can suffer a little bit actually trying to score the points to win the game that way.
I think that's becoming less and less of a problem due to... it's becoming less of a problem now because there are more and more neutral ice that can stop...
So you're importing ice from elsewhere.
And there are a couple of really good ice for cheap that you can, like an influence point each.
Yeah, some of the mythic ice could be to score out behind.
The Grail ice is very very popular in certain builds. Wraparound for an influence is fantastic. I'm actually starting to pull in a HB ice that doesn't see much play.
Yeah.
Because it's got really good synergy with what I'm trying to do.
Which ice is that?
Rotor Turret.
Okay.
4 for 0 strength.
Yeah, it's a 0 strength centric. It's from the core set.
It is from the core set.
And it's a card I've looked at and discounted many a time.
Every HB deck I've built looks at it and goes, it's crap.
Yeah. So what does it makes it fit in with your Jinteki ideas?
It ends the run.
Yep.
Which is nice. And it trashes a program.
Yes.
And that is what I'm going to be aiming towards. It's 4 to res and 0 strength. So it is not a good defensive ice unless they don't have a way to get through sentries.
Yes.
If they don't, it's amazing.
Yeah.
But if they
just a nice early game ice before they've set up, but they're face checking and they're trying to work.
Yeah, whereas the deck I'm planning, it's going to be both an early game and a late game ice.
Okay, how's it going to work in the late game then? If they've got a sentry breaker that can normally break it for a credit,
then the plan is that they don't have sentry breakers anymore.
Okay,
it takes them away. The entire deck will be removing their sentries. So I have scoured the archives of Netrunner for sentries that end the run because they don't do it very often.
Okay.
But there's like 3.
Okay, cool.
And they're going to... It's
so you can have lots of sentries that end the run and then cards in your hand to get rid of their sentry breaker, which then lets them run into the other things and lose the rest of their rig.
It's quite hard to kill sentries with... to kill any breakers with operations.
Yeah.
So I'm using ice to kill them.
Okay.
With things that let me use things on ice.
Okay, yeah. Cool. Yeah, we'll come to it later. excellent, right. So let's just go through some of the... We've talked about quite a few of these already, actually.
We have.
We're talking sort of the key cards that define the faction, or at least at this point in time.
Yeah.
Because this is the thing with Netrunner. In a year, we might look back at this and go, we were so naive. We didn't see this coming and that coming. And what about that thing from that neutral card from Terminal Directive that completely changed the meta? So at the moment...
I can't wait for that one.
It's going to be my favourite.
Yeah, okay. For anyone that doesn't know, you flip it over, it costs 0. It says, if the opponent's playing Wizard, punch him in the face, you win the game.
This Wizard's dead.
Yes.
Yeah, he got shot. I saw it. Exactly. It's on a card.
There's also a runner version that does the same for CTM.
So we have we talked about some of the traps being quite good. We talked about the Fetal AI and Future Perfect that are agendas that protect themselves. Some of the other agendas that I quite like, that I feel you'll see a lot of if you're playing as or against Jinteki. Mm-hmm. House of Knives is one of
them. Ooh, it's good.
I like House of Knives.
That's going in the deck.
Yes. Very, very good. It's a 3-1.
Yep.
That gets 3 tokens when it's scored.
Yes.
Each token, you can only use it once per run.
And only during a run.
And only during a run. But when the runner runs at you, you can then spend a counter from House of Knives and immediately do a net damage. And it is so Jinteki. It's like immediately aggressive.
Well, you can trigger it at any point during the run.
Yes.
So if they're kind of going, 3 cards, I can get through this, I can just take the damage. And they go, ha ha, that's fine. And then right at the end of the run, or right at the beginning of the run, or just halfway through to annoy them, just before they get to that unresed card,
Yes. Their
unresed ice. Or if they're going, cool, I will draw, I'll make sure I've got 6 cards and run that 3 times advanced card, because if it's a June bug, I can survive.
Ping, you've got 5, what do you do?
Yeah. And straight back into horrible decisions.
Yes. And what's also brilliant is I had against you the other day, Joe, I scored 2 of them very early on.
Yes.
And then was able to snipe 2 cards out of your hand.
Once I pointed out you could use both.
Yeah, because we had to look it up, because I was like, can I do this? Yeah, you can.
Well, because it says this ability can only be used during a run and only once per run.
Yeah.
It's the fact that the ability is separate because it's in 2 different places.
Yes. Yeah.
You can't spend two counters.
That's what I needed to check.
Yeah, yeah. No two counters from the same card, but if you've got 2 scored, you can spend a counter from each.
Yes.
It's really good. Because it's just like the Nisei Marte, you can stop them doing things that they thought they could do.
Yes. Another agenda I'm looking forward to is Okabata Protocol. Feel the confidence in my voice.
What?
Okabata.
No.
Obakata?
Obakata.
Ah!
Nearly! So close, but seeming so stupid.
Yes. Obakata Protocol, which is a... Is that a 5-3?
It is a 5-3.
5-3 that has an additional cost to steal of 4 net damage.
So, yes, as an additional cost to steal Obakata Protocol, the runner must suffer 4 net damage. So the runner can opt to not pay this cost.
Yeah.
So it's not quite as horrible in a I'm trying to kill you deck as Fetal AI.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it kind of is.
Yes.
Because if you've got 3 of those, and you install them, and you have horrible things like Genetics Pavilion that says you can only draw 2 cards on your turn, and Chairman Hero that says the runner's got 2 less hand size, maybe you're enforcing some curfews at the same time.
Yeah.
And basically just going, you can't get enough cards to
steal
take it.
It
without dying.
Yeah. So it's going to sit there looking at you.
Yeah. And they can't even do it with 3 cards in hands to win the game because it's a cost to steal that they have to pay before they get the points.
Yes.
So it's really, really good. We're both excited for this.
Yes, yeah. And being able to, they go, all right, I will make sure I've got enough cards. No, I will House of Knives you on the way in. One of the key cards I find, I think you might disagree with me, Joe, is a card I really like, which is Neural EMP.
Yes.
It's a core card, costs 2 to play, and it does 1 net damage immediately.
Yeah.
They go, I will. I've got 5 cards in hand. I'm going to run in there. I'm going to steal that. I'll take my 4 net damage. Oh, you've House of Knives me. Cool. If they're not drawing back up immediately, if they've had to build up to that because of the other damage you've done them elsewhere, it's very easy to finish people off with Neural EMPs. I've got a few kills with them recently where I've managed to get them to 0 cards.
Yeah.
And that's normally not your kill. And then you just chuck one of those down, spend your 2, and you're done.
So, you know, it's interesting because we figured out an average cost of 12 for 3 damage, maybe, for a Ronin. Yeah. You're taking clicks at being about 1.5.
Yeah.
So this is 3.5 for one.
Yeah.
It's a bit cheaper.
Potentially.
But yeah. I don't like it.
Yeah, you don't like it. I really like it. It's won me several games recently, so I'm quite happy with it.
I'm not really sure what it is. I just... might be the fact that I've not gotten kills off it. But I'm not the biggest fan of the card.
No, it doesn't.
It's not something that makes it into my decks over other things. I'd rather have a Ronin or something, for example.
Yeah, I just have both. It's fine.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I really like Nerulean. Yes. But your mileage may vary.
if you've got a 3 advanced Ronin that you can advance trash and then EMP, you've got 4 damage out, which is cool.
Yes.
And then you do some other things on top of that we'll come to when we discuss your deck.
So if you're actively looking to kill, it can expand that kill range of how many cards have you got? You ask that question.
It opens that window a little bit further. Yes.
Yeah. That's what I quite like about it. A card that I really like that, again, is a direct damage card. It's a really strange direct damage card. A lot of the cards in Jinteki feel quite, to me at least, maybe it's because I'm less experienced, but they feel quite unique. The agenda, Philotic Entanglement.
Yes.
Now, Philotic Entanglement is a 3-2 agenda. It's a one-off. You can only have one in your deck.
For good reason.
Because when it is scored, you do a net damage for each agenda in the runner's score area. So if the runner, quite a lot of Jinteki decks will run lots of small point agendas. If you're playing something like PE, where your ability is firing every time an agenda is scored or stolen, you want to use that ability more often, so you'll have more smaller point agendas. And you can afford to give a few of those away.
Yeah.
Especially if you don't have any threes in your deck, because the point where you need to go, oh, actually, they could win next go, is 5, not 4.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you could do... I think I did 6 net damage against someone down the pub with this the other day.
That's including your one from the ability.
Plus one, they had 5 one-point agendas. Oh, they had 4 one-point agendas and the current that counts as an agenda.
Freedom through Apollo.
Yes.
Yes.
Because it is added to your score area as an agenda.
Yes, that's actually what I was going to bring up with this. Because... you can get to, before they've won the game by scoring agendas.
Yeah.
I believe the highest you can get would be to be dealing, out of PE, 16 net damage from scoring that.
Go on then.
So, 3, Project Kusanagi, because there are 0 points.
Yeah.
3, Shaikyu.
Which are minus...
oh, no, even more. Jesus Christ.
Okay.
18.
Okay.
3 Shaikyu. It's a trap. When the runner accesses it, you may pay X. So you pay as much as you want.
Yeah.
The runner can either take that amount in net damage or add it to their score area as an agenda worth minus one.
Yeah. So you could put them... they could have 6 agendas in hand at all and be at minus 3 points. At this point.
Cool. So then you pour in some news teams from MBN, which give them tags, or they put it in their thing, and they might opt to.
So that puts you at minus 6.
Is it minus? Oh, it might be minus. Yeah, so it does put minus 6. You might even be able to hit 21 at this point.
Wow. you must take two tags or add news team to your score area as an agenda worth minus 1 point.
So we're currently dealing 9 damage and they've got minus 6 points.
Yes. That's a bit of a kick in the teeth when you're losing that badly.
Yeah, you can then add in 3 House of Knives that they could score. That's fine. Because that puts you up to minus 3 with... and you just carry on like that, basically. So it's a ridiculous
sum. 6-3-0. So as long as you've got... enough. Yeah, there's more than 4 one-point agendas in the game, so that's...
horrible.
6, 12. 12 on top of that. Yeah, so you're doing like 18.
Even if you don't put the news team in, you just use Jinteki and neutral cards. There are still a lot of horrible ways you can do that.
Yeah, not going to happen often. And it's if they steal that out of R&D, then that plan is gone, because there's only one of them. Now, Philotic isn't something that's completely unstoppable, because you've still got to play it out and score it.
Yeah, but you've only got one.
Yeah, you've only got one, so you've got to find it. And it can get... I've had it stolen in the first turn before, so...
Yeah.
And there's other ways of countering it as well?
Well, there are ways to reduce the number of agendas in your score area.
Yeah.
For example, you can use the Shaper card Artist Colony.
Yep.
That allows you to sacrifice an agenda from your score area.
Yeah.
Or forfeit an agenda, that's the correct terminology. And tutor out any card from your deck.
Yes.
So if you go, like, if I'm ever playing a Shaper deck that has those in them, fucking love news teams. Love yeah. Shy Qs, because they're just easy ways to get my cards.
Yeah.
If you're criminal, you include a probably just like maybe a one-off of Data Dealer.
Yeah.
Which does the same thing. You pay a click as well, I believe. Forfeit yeah. the agenda and gain 9 credits.
Yeah. And so if you've got a few connections in there, you can get them out with a hostage.
Yeah, so things like that work nicely. There are ways around it. It's not just like, oh my god, amazing.
Yeah.
But it's a nice way to finish off a game sometimes.
Yeah, I shall score my points and kill you.
Yeah.
Ideally, you'd want to have 5 points and then win with agenda points and kill and them at the same time.
For bragging rights and...
some kind
probably
of...
probably demand a beer or out of them or something.
Yeah, just do a sexy victory dance.
On the table with your cock out.
If that's
that it's your speciality, Brian.
It is, because I am a sexy cat, as noted in previous podcasts. Yeah, so any other cards you think are kind of key Jinteki cards, kind of cards you could build your deck around or that you see in lots and lots of different yes. Decks?
I think Mushin Noshin is a key card.
Yes. That is what I built my current Jinteki deck yes. around.
That I plan on using in future, because yes. I think it's a very good card.
Yeah, so it's a double click.
Yep.
So it costs 2 clicks to play.
And any credits?
No,
it's free.
0 credits. Cool. It allows you to then make a new server.
Yes.
You install an asset or an agenda with 3 advancement tokens on it already. Then you can't score it until next turn.
Oh, no.
And suddenly the game becomes a case of your opponent needing to guess what that is. Is that a Ronin that I'm going to kill you with next turn? Is it a Project June bug that's going to do you 6 net damage? Or is it an agenda that yeah. I will advance to advance, you know, maybe even to score, to win the game? I really like Mushin Noshin.
It's a good card. And... as we'll mention later, we got some pretty copies of it as well.
Yes, we did at the GNK. It's so pretty. Because the original artwork isn't very nice, but I do like the new ones.
It's not bad. It's just not inspiring.
No. And it is such a good card. It deserves a very pretty pretty picture.
I would agree.
Yes, I really like that. I'm a big fan of Mushin.
Okay, so let's have just having a think if there's anything else that's particularly... they've got some of the unique cards.
Yeah.
Medical Breakthrough as an agenda is a unique
yes.
thing.
Yeah, this is on my list of cards that maybe not key and you'll see in every deck, but it's a really interesting card.
Mm.
It's a 4/2, and when one has been scored, the next medical breakthrough costs 1 less advancement to score. So your second one is 3, your third one is 2.
Yes.
The real kicker with this, because this is a nice sort of snowballing effect.
Well, that's a fairly unique snowballing effect. I don't yeah. know anything else that does that.
No. But what it does on top of that is that ability still activates when it's in the runner's score area.
Yes.
So if the runner steals one from you, you've suddenly got 2 3/2s left in your deck.
Yeah. God forbid they steal 2.
And then the next one, you can install advance.
2/2?
Yeah, it's a 2/2.
Which is amazing.
Yeah, there's no such thing.
No.
In the actual card pool, you have this 2/2. Yeah, they've got 4 of your points, but you can catch up that deficit very, very quickly just by drawing the right card. even and if you've scored two yourself, it's still a 2-2.
Yeah.
If you're going to fast advance Jinteki, I would expect to see that.
Yes, definitely.
If you're going to try to twist them into that. Trick of Light is a card I know you're not as keen on as I am.
It needs a deck almost specifically built with it in mind.
Yeah, can do.
It massively helps certain... certain builds, certain identities. It helps Tenin Institute a ton. But I don't think it has a place in every deck.
No. One of the things I find, though, is because I like to play the traps.
Yes.
And I like the advanceable traps because they're more powerful.
Yes.
And you can end up with quite a few cards installed with advancement tokens on them that are just sitting there.
Yeah, especially if the runner's managed to expose the card, so it knows.
Yeah, if they've exposed one of your traps, so you've got a four advanced Project Junebug sat there, they're never going to run it.
No.
But with the Trick of Light, it allows you to move agenda tokens from one card, advancement tokens, sorry, from one card to another.
Yeah.
So it then becomes like a little bank.
Yeah,
that sat there that you can start moving things that's around.
Fairly safe, because if they run it to get rid of it, they're going to get punched in the face.
Yes, yeah. So, it's a really good card if you're going to try to fast advance, or if scoring quickly is maybe your plan B.
Yeah.
To include a couple of those. Another card I really like for a similar effect is Mind Game. Very cheap. In fact, it costs nothing.
Yeah.
Code Gate. Bit of ice, you pop it down. Strength 4.
Which is nice. Yeah. It's a respectable level.
Yes. It has the one subroutine, which is a side game. And if you spend different amounts of money, different number of credits, you move the runner so they're running on a different server.
Starting at the outermost piece of ice?
Yes, yeah.
Which is great if you set up a horrible killie server.
Yep.
Or a trap.
Yes, so you can plonk them onto a trap. And then if they want to jack out, they have to take an installed card and put it on the bottom of their deck. Now, if they hit that really early, I doubt you'd ever get someone who hasn't got anything installed.
Nine, even if it's just something minor, like a Temujin Contract, a single breaker maybe, another key piece that's mostly going to sit there and fast.
Yeah, but if they're... You can also get them to go, well, actually, no, I'll carry on. They might hit something nasty.
Yeah.
You can dump them into archives for 3 shock damage, for instance.
Yeah, if you've got them in there.
Yeah.
You can also, if they, you know that they're unsure of whether or not they should be running on a certain card.
Yeah.
Because it might be an agenda, it might not, and they've not figured it out yet. Direct them to that.
Yeah.
Because they will then believe it's a trap.
Yes, and then next turn you can score it.
Happily. Yeah, so yeah. It's irritated me plenty of times playing against you.
Yeah.
It is a very good card.
Yeah, I really like that.
Yeah.
I really, really like that card, because it gets, like, trickle. It lets you get a use out of something that otherwise might just be sat there stale and not doing anything.
I think there's one other card that needs a mention because of how popular it is.
Yeah.
And I think there's also one other card that you're wanting to mention.
Cool. The one that's really popular then
is Caprice.
Yep.
When a run is successful, I believe, on a server that has Caprice installed.
Yep. So she's an upgrade, isn't she?
She is an upgrade. She's a Sisoph.
Yeah.
When a run is successful, you make a Psy game. If you spend a different number of credits, the run ends.
Yep.
So that's a very nice way of protecting agendas.
Yeah.
And it also, it's very similar to Ash from HB.
Yeah.
But Ash means they can only access Ash. So you can trash it and just go in again.
Yeah, you can't trash Nisei until you win a Psy game.
Yeah, you have to get through her Psy game. So everything in that server is safe.
Yeah.
Which I think is really good. She only has a very small trash cost of 1, But again, she's safe because you need to get in there.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's a solid server defense card that you can combine with other things to make it slightly nastier.
But yeah.
It's good.
Yes, it's very, very good card. The other big upgrade for Jinteki is Marcus Batty.
Yes, a favourite of both of ours.
Yeah, I've imported him especially into my HB deck that was looking to brain damage you.
Yep.
You res him, you trash him, and you play a side game again.
Yep.
If you spend different amounts, so essentially if the Corp wins the side game,
yep.
You get to pick a routine, subroutine on any bit of ice
on that server,
and it goes off
straight away.
Yeah, so I was using him to trigger the easily clicked through brain damage abilities of HB Biotic Ice.
Yeah,
but you can do extra net damage.
My deck is using him to trigger trash program subroutines.
Yes,
so you trash their Sentry Breaker.
Yeah,
when they come to your Sentry. If it's a rotor turret, it then gets to trash another program because they can't break it anymore,
yeah.
And it ends the run.
Yes.
So, yeah, it's tasty.
It sounds janktastic.
It is.
But I quite like the idea of stuff like that.
Yeah.
It'd be boring if we were all playing the top three decks that are the three decks that work against the other top three decks on the other side.
Yeah.
I quite like the variety that's there. Yeah. I think that's... we haven't talked too much about their ice.
No.
They have a couple of ice that I think are, again, maybe splashed for elsewhere.
Yeah.
And quite good. Because of their... Not because of necessarily their basic effects and their subroutines, but their special abilities. So you have Lotus Field.
Which is... only getting better right now.
Yes. You can't lower the strength of a Lotus Field.
So the...
current Cypher Parasite, reduce you to zero, trash your ice.
Or even just reducing to zero, because that console is rampant now.
Yes, yeah. Making it easy to break for various...
For any breaker, really.
Breakers, yeah.
Is really good.
Yes, really, really good. It just ends the run.
Yeah.
And you also have Swordsman... Swordsman cannot be broken using an AI.
Yeah.
So you can't break it using an AI program, and it will trash an AI program if it's encountered, and it will then do a net damage. It won't stop the run.
No, but it does potentially remove, especially in a meta where a lot of people are using things like Faust, Eater.
Yeah, Keyhole Eater is... because you always use it good. A lot, yeah. And therefore it's kind of like the bane of my net running at the moment. So a couple swordsmen on R&D will stop that.
Yes,
quite nicely. Well, it won't stop it, but it will massively. Well, it might actually trash your eater, and therefore it's stopped.
Yeah,
yeah, it's that's gone it. Away completely.
And that's trashing programs is really powerful.
Yes, it is
really powerful.
Because you get to pick.
Yeah.
And you know what programs they need.
Because you know what ice is coming up.
Yeah.
They might not. Yeah. So, yeah, that's fantastic. A lot of their other ice, it's a weird one faction-wise because, say, HB and Wayland, most of their ice do the same kind of things.
Yeah.
It's just variations on numbers and routines and stuff. Whereas Jinteki's ice is weird and wonderful. A lot of it does net damage.
Yeah.
There's a lot of side games for things like... drawing cards and stuff like that. But again, a lot of it's... some of it benefits the runner. Harvester. It has two routines and both of them are... the runner draws three cards, then discards to maximum hand size. The runner draws three cards, discards to maximum hand size. For some runners, in some positions, that's fantastic.
Yeah.
But
for some runners, if they're not running a levy, you may have just taken six cards out of their overall.
Or if they've got a really nice hand already... they've got to make some hard choices.
Yeah.
Ikey as well is really cheap. If you score a different number, the runner draws two cards, and then you do two net damage.
Yeah.
So if you win the side game, you're can't kill them with it because they've drawn the cards that will, but you are trashing cards. And so there's a lot of variation in there, and it's one of the factions that unfortunately you're more going to have to just sit and read through and figure out what ice works best for you where.
It is a tricks and ruses faction.
Yes. They do have some solid end the run ice, but you pay for it.
Yeah, things like Wall of Thorns.
Yeah, do 2 net damage end the run. It's nasty. But it costs you 8.
Yeah, it's expensive.
You've then got Chiashi, one of the newer ones.
Yep.
Same thing. More net damage. Still ends the run. Costs you 12.
Yeah, and you're in a faction that doesn't make a lot of money.
Yes.
And that's one of the things, is that that 12 may as well be 20 for most of the games I've played.
Yeah. Yeah, apart from the RP deck, because that makes all the money.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they do have some ways of making money. They do. So, moving away then from the most valuable cards, onto the different kinds of archetypes. And we talked a little bit about the fact I've been playing Jinteki.
Yep.
I've been playing... excuse me. I've been playing Personal Evolution.
Yeah.
And I have been playing a deck that you found for me.
I did.
On Netrunner DB, which is the Show of Force equals 3 more Ronin deck by, I hope I pronounced this right, FET23 on Netrunner Database. Thank you very much. I've had a great time playing that deck. And this deck works around putting out, using Mushin no Shin, and it's got lots of ways to bring that back into your hand or to get it shuffled back into R&D, putting out lots and lots of advanced cards that your opponent then has to decide whether or not they are a trap, and it runs a lot of traps.
Yeah.
It has Project Junebugs. It has Cerebral Overwriters as well, which do brain damage.
Which is a HB card.
Yeah, it's a HB card that they've splashed in. Or whether they think it's an agenda, and we've got 3 fetals in there, so you can still do some damage with your agendas. If it's a Ronin, then I'm 2 clicks off being able to do 3 points of damage to you. And Show of Force is a great card. It's a 4-2. It's quite recent, isn't it?
Last cycle.
Towards the end.
Yeah.
Agenda 4-2, neutral agenda. When it's scored, you do 2 point of meat damage, which you then add in the personal evolution damage of 1 net damage because you scored an agenda, suddenly it becomes a 3 damage card. Yeah.
And it's quite nice to include that actually because it diversifies your damage output.
Yeah, so if they load up on net damage, you might be able to sneak out some cheeky meat damage and confuse them. And again, it's a really directly aggressive card. It is one of the few. Quite often in Netrunner, you're waiting for the runner to do something so you can get them. You can spring your trap.
Well, I'd argue most of Netrunner is waiting for the right window.
Yes.
Whether it's to run on a server, whether it's to advance an agenda, anything like that. It's all about identifying windows of opportunity.
Yeah. And this, I've won a game. Opponent had 5 cards in hand. I'd Mushin'd a Ronin.
Yep.
Much, much earlier in the game, they decided it was a trap and it was left there. I then Mushin'd out Show of Force, and I clicked, advanced my Show of Force, and scored it. Clicked, advanced my Ronin, flipped over my Ronin, clicked and trashed it, and I did 6 points of damage in total and killed them from a start, like a full hand of 5 cards. Really fun. I do feel like a bit of a bastard when I do that, because it's kind of like, I've decided that the game is over. You're dead. Because... again, Netrunner doesn't normally have that ability to be so directly aggressive as the Corp.
Well, you say that. I think that's changing. I think we are more and more and more moving into directly aggressive tactics as things, you know.
But
the escalation that has occurred during the game. I think it's a thing that's coming in, and I quite like it.
Yeah, but you're looking at maybe the really effective kill decks now are sort of power shutdown railgun type decks through MBN, which they make my brain hurt and I go slightly cross-eyed when I think about them. But they require getting these pieces in the right place and this many credits, and then you go, ha ha, I've won.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas this is much more. There's many different ways to directly assault the runner.
Yes.
It was very weird playing Jinteki to start with. This might be something that people need to bear in mind, because I didn't have a lot of strong ice and I couldn't protect everything. Mm-hmm. And as someone who kind of grew up in Netrunner playing Wayland, I'm used to going, and here is my end the run, and here is my end the run, and here is my other end the run.
Look at all of it. Yes. All of it is end the run.
Everything is ended. There is no running here.
Yeah.
Whereas this was going, well, I'll poke them a bit and I'll jab them and I'll move them to a different server, but I'm not really stopping them.
Yeah.
And the deck actually splashes for three pop-up windows, which I kind of looked at and went, that's really odd. But they just give you this little, you put them where you know they're going to run.
There's two reasons for that in the deck.
Yeah.
One, that it's a little bit of income.
It's the income I like.
Two, it gets you to a required number of NBN cards to include one of the Alliance cards.
Yes, which is...
Salem's Hospitality?
Yes. Salem's Hospitality, name a card, look in their... look at their...
You name a card and the runner reveals their grip and you trash all copies of that card. Yes. In their grip.
Yeah. Why is that there, Joe? Because I didn't realise why it was there until I did it.
I would argue one of its big targets is I've Had Worse.
Yes. Because if you're doing lots of little bits of damage, I've Had Worse can be a real pain when you're playing against Anarchs, because... You trash that one card, they draw three more, your kill is no longer on.
Yeah, if you trash I've Had Worse through net or meat damage, the runner gets to draw three cards.
Yeah. So it lets you... I used it against someone playing some Anarchs, and I went, I've Had Worse, and it went away, and then I went,
dead.
You're dead. Yes. So it's a nice sort of hard counter to that.
It is. I mean, it's also quite useful if you're playing against, like, criminals, you might just straight away go, Demogorgon Contract, to maybe trash one.
Yes.
Because there isn't any other stuff on there. You know, it works really, really nicely in... I can't remember if it's Harpsichord or Hashishandra Studios.
Yeah.
But one of them, when the runners from NBN, when the runners tag, they play with their grip revealed.
Yes.
So you go, what you got? Those ones, I'll play this.
I'll name that card there.
Because I know you've got them there.
Account Siphon can be quite a nice one to name.
Yeah, again, against criminals or some wizards.
And one thing I'd like to do is to have a cheeky Mushined Kronos Protocol. It's one of the changes I made to the deck as it is online. Yeah. I added Kronos Protocols to it rather than... They had a... Is it Giller Arcology?
Gallahan's Arcology, I think.
Which lets you... You can click twice for 3 credits.
Yeah.
And I didn't bother with that. I think we put in a celebrity gift.
We did.
Which I like as a card to go, here is what I've got. I shall have lots of money.
Yeah.
Because I feel safe playing Jinteki PE to reveal a hand that has both a trap and an agenda in it. And then maybe installing one card, advancing it, and going, right, you decide which one I've just put in there.
Yeah.
You decide. Which I quite like. I quite like that. By being able to shoot a Levy out of hand, for instance.
Oh, yes.
So you name Levy. There it goes. Then you go, haha, earlier I prepared this time warp with my space time travel buddies. And off you go. It's Marcus Batty. That's what he's doing. Travelling back in time.
I would make a Back to the Future joke if I knew any.
Yeah. You don't like Back to the Future.
I don't.
See last week's podcast for more of Joe's insightful film criticism. and the adventures of racist Brum in Shia LaBeouf.
That's
I really, really enjoyed that deck because it lets me be hyper aggressive.
Yeah,
it lets me ask the player opposite me on the table to make decisions.
Mm-hmm.
Are they going to run that, or are they going to let me score it potentially? Are they going to are they going to risk that ice early on, knowing it's probably quite porous, but it's going to give them damage.
Yeah.
it becomes very much a bluffing sort of mind game. And I like that. That's something you that could, really appeals to me.
You could also play a very, 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 very similar deck out of PU.
Potential Unleashed, yeah.
Where every time you deal at least one net damage, so each instance of net damage,
yeah,
causes them to trash the top card of their stack.
Yes.
It has a bit less influence. Only has 12, not 15.
Ooh, cheeky.
And things like Show of Force become less good because it's doing meat damage, not net.
Yeah, so you'd probably swap that for something else.
But things like House of Knives, they run in and you go, ping, I do you a damage.
And the top card
is card goes. So you start to actually mill the runner, which is quite nice.
Yeah, yeah. I like the look of that. I think yes, I may try that next.
Next topic.
But I'm still really enjoying PE. Whereas yeah. I've been, since I gave up on Argus as a bad deal, yeah. I've bounced around quite a lot. I've played quite
and
this, a lot.
This has been things. Somewhere you've settled.
Yeah, and I've stuck on this one. Oh, this is really fun.
Yeah, so another archetype that's available to Jinteki is the prison archetype.
Yeah.
Now, I've been playing this recently.
Yeah.
I really like it.
Yeah.
And I don't think it's as bad as Brian does. Oh. Now, I'm gonna justify it with your reasoning for liking your deck.
Okay, cool.
You like your deck because you push them into decisions.
Yeah.
Now, the decisions you push them into, each one of them could break the game.
Yeah.
Every single one of them could end it.
Yeah. So, yeah,
because it could be a huge June bug hit. It could be a, you've only got a hand size of two or one now because you hit an overwriter. Or,
yeah, you do a big chunk of brain damage and then you just play your two neural AMP one after the other and kill them.
Yeah, so you're going for big flashy plays.
Yeah.
Now, the prison deck is trying to kill the runner.
Yeah.
But what it's doing is it's making the runner make lots of little decisions.
Yeah.
Turn after turn. You can pretty much run every single card in that deck. Most of them aren't going to hurt you.
Yeah.
Maybe two or three. But if you don't get rid of the right ones in the right order, the deck will slowly crush you.
Yeah. So the prison deck is a type of sort of asset spam deck. Wherein you have lots and lots of installed servers and then lots of cards that are, like you say, maybe not nasty on their own, but combined together to sort of give the runner almost like an unwinnable
situation. Yeah, the key components are bioethics association. If you can't ice this server, otherwise it doesn't work.
Yeah.
But at the beginning of your turn, you get to do one net damage to the opponent.
Yeah. And so, they're not unique, so you can have three of those.
Now, so that's pretty cool.
Now, what's stopping me just running that and trashing it next turn in a prison
you
deck?
You also can have your hostile infrastructures.
Okay.
5 to res, 5 to trash. Pretty beefy card. Every time the runner trashes a corp card, they take a point of net damage.
Yes.
Which, again, aren't unique.
Yeah. And if you trash a hostile infrastructure, it still does its net damage as it goes, no, mother, and dies.
And explodes in your face.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. So, yeah, that protects them a bit.
The other thing is the idea abilities that you've been using give protection.
Yeah, the two main ones that run the prison are Industrial Genomics, which every face-down card in Archives adds 1 to the trash cost of the corp cards.
Yes.
So it might be 1 to res and 2 to trash a bioethics, but if I've got 5 face-down cards, that's 7 to trash.
That's ridiculous money.
It is.
But that hostile infrastructure becomes 10.
Yeah, but you can just run into Archives, look at all my things, and then it's back down to 2.
Yeah, but you'll obviously have put 3 shocks in there.
And possibly some shy cues just to go, ha 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 ha,
yeah.
Have all this
and
stuff.
And you'll also ice Archives far earlier and in a far stronger way than you would.
So that on its own is part of the kill.
Yeah.
You have Ronins in there to do the same thing you did, just to quicken it a little bit.
Yeah.
But you also play things like Chairman Hero, who, as we talked, the new upstart.
Yeah, yeah.
Reducing the runner's hand size by 2.
I really hope he's named after Hero Protagonist from Snow Crash.
Excellent.
Just as a...
Yay trivia.
Yeah. Bit of literary knowledge coming in there.
But So that keeps them in a slightly more manageable kill situation. Yep. You have Genetics Pavilion, like I mentioned earlier. Yep. The runner can only draw two cards during their turn.
Yeah.
So again, if you've got three bioethics out that they can't trash, they can't win.
They're losing a card. They're going to lose
until they're dead.
Unless they can find a way to trash the right cards, but then they might take more damage
because of the hostiles. Yeah. And it just builds up this horrible thing.
It's like being in prison. You get stuck and you can't escape, and it just kind of whittles you down.
Yeah, there are things you can do, like play Wizard with Salset Slums and laugh because it doesn't trigger hostiles and you get to remove from the game, and it makes it very, very hard to win.
Yeah, bitter experience for the weekend, Joe.
Still shot him, though. Well, stabbed him with a Ronin. But it's a very, very oppressive deck. Because if you don't know how to fight against it, you're not going to make the right choices early, and it's going to get going and it's going to kill you.
Yeah. I like what you've done with that is you've included dedication ceremonies for your Ronin.
For my Ronin, yes.
Because that's add three...
Three counters for one credit.
For one credit. So you... And you get to install as you do it? Or is it you've already got it installed and on the board somewhere?
You place three advancement tokens on a face-up card.
Cool. So you res the Ronin, put the three on it. If that's your first click.
Yeah.
Your second click is to advance it. Your second click is to fire it and win the game.
Yes.
Yeah. I've been tempted to maybe slip a couple of those in.
It speeds up the Ronin really nicely. Yeah. And if you've got out Chairman Hero and a... Enforced curfew to drop their hand size by three.
Yeah.
Especially if you've got the curfew out, most people sit there going, oh, hand size four, that's fine.
Yeah.
But if you res a hero at the end of their turn, they've got to discard down to two cards. Yes. A face down untouched Ronin kills them.
Yeah.
And that's how I've won a lot of games recently.
Yeah, yeah. It's got that. Nastiness, that kind of that synergy of this little thing does this little ability, this one makes it worse, and then this one does a
thing.
But
it's interesting because it's a 49 card deck that runs six ice.
Yeah.
So, and like you say, how it being uninteractive, because I don't think it is. I just think it requires very specific interactions.
I like the fact that I haven't actually had to advance any of my arguments. You've remembered my arguments and then you're telling me why I'm wrong.
Yeah.
It's quite interesting because it feels like we're having a discussion, but it's all you.
Yeah. It's much like you're playing against IG.
Yes, exactly.
But this is it. I mean, you have this...
Yeah, I just felt that playing against it, and this isn't a criticism of it as such, because... The game has lots of different styles and different ways of playing. And we know that we all, as players, I think, favour certain styles and certain different things.
Yeah, definitely.
I felt I knew exactly what I needed to do against you, but it was impossible because there was just no way of generating enough credits to trash all of the things.
Yeah.
So I felt from like the third turn onwards, I'm like, right, I'm going to die horribly here.
Yeah.
But there's ways around it. I have beaten that deck.
Yes.
By ignoring everything you were doing and just piling up a load of mediums and running into R&D and shouting a lot.
That's a very good way of doing it. The other way is to repeatedly kill any draw.
Because it will import things like Sensi.
Two Sensis, two Jacksons usually, and uses them to draw.
Yeah.
Now, it's a very good archetype.
Yeah, yeah.
In tournament settings, I've lost a game with it.
Yes.
Across the store championships and the Q1 kit.
Yeah.
And I really like it. Now, what I think of as an evolution of that is, which it isn't because I think they came out in different orders, but... The Replicate and Perfection ID.
Yes.
Where runners can't initiate a run on a remote server unless they have already initiated a run on a central server.
Yeah.
Becomes really good because rather than using horrible amounts of potential damage to keep them off servers, you use the fact that they've got to spend a click running a central. Which means they've got to hit a piece of ice.
Yeah.
And because you're using more assets... and the way it works, it's got turtle backs in there, so every time you make a server, it goes, ha ha ha, I get a credit.
Yeah. they're not unique. So they're not unique, so you have three of those.
I make a new server, I get three credits.
Yeah.
That server's a sundew. You can't spend your first click running that, so I get two credits, and they're not unique, and it gets to the point where it stacks up tons of money.
Yeah, and it also has, what card is it you're using that gives you money to res cards?
It uses the Mumbad Temple, so I don't spend the money to res the cards.
Yeah, because at one point you sat there and you had 37 credits.
Yeah.
I remember that number. Because I remember going, how many credits have you got? 37. That's ridiculous.
Yeah.
Okay. And then I hit a piece of ice, and you spend no money to res a 6-credit piece of ice that then punched me in the face.
Yeah, yeah.
And you still had... Yeah, and I was like, is this just redundancy? Is this...
Kind of.
But if you get them in the cards in a certain order, you'll get those earlier.
Yeah.
And it helps you get to that point
yes.
later.
So you also import from Wayland, the Mumbad City Hall, which lets you find those cards and tutor them out of your deck.
You had IT... Is it Interns?
No, Tech Startup.
Tech Startup, that's the one.
So you can essentially have...
Staffed by Interns, though.
Yeah, just... yeah. But there is a lot of way... That deck is, again, it's not my own creation. It's something I found online and have changed a couple of bits on.
Yes, yeah.
But it's a beautiful synergy of cards. And that's one of the things I like in this game. I love how fantastically synergistic certain decks can be.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think... I genuinely think that's probably better... than IG.
Yeah.
If you have an infinite time to play your games in.
Yeah.
Because I think it's harder to break through that deck because of the money. It uses more and better ice. Uses things like Chiyashi that's cost 12.
Yeah.
And Hammers Runners just because it's... And it's got like 3 data trackers in, which are expensive. To res 3... bits of the two most expensive bits of ice in that deck is more than it costs to res and play every single card in the IG deck.
Nice.
For the scope of variance.
Yeah,
Like, for example, IG plays Breaker Break Grids to reduce the res cost by 5, so you get your hostiles out for free.
Yeah.
PU doesn't bother because it's just raking in money.
Yeah.
It's interesting.
Yeah.
But it's slow, so I wouldn't take it to a tournament because I don't think it's quick enough. It might be me that's not doing the things in the right order.
But you do have, it's what, 70, and at 65 or 70 minutes to play 2 rounds of Netrunner, so it becomes tricky in a tournament.
Yeah, so I think...
I think part of why people underestimate Glacier, because if you're going to sit and play a game for an hour and just play one round, it can be really, really good. But if you're trying to actually win 2 games,
well,
it can be slow.
I think that's part of it. I think the other part of it is that there are so many cards that punish Glacier.
Yeah, definitely. But I enjoy a nice Glacier.
Oh, yeah. And some of the key runner archetypes are currently hosed by Glacier.
Yeah.
But because it's not a popular archetype, it's fine to have that as your weak matchup because it's weak to most of the other things.
Yeah. It's a kind of whole... It's like rock, paper, scissors, but it's like Modem, Power Surge... I don't know. No, it's like, I'm trying to make it into a cyberpunk version. You've got Machine Gun, Subdermal Implants, and then... Kevlar knives that can slice through arm. No, I'm going too far again, aren't I?
Kevlar knives?
Not Kevlar. what I meant to say was monofilament knives that can slice through Kevlar, but then I said Kevlar knives
and
that can slice through monofilaments, and I got lost.
But
this is why all my writing I get to edit, so I don't it can be shit first time and then I can make it better.
And for your amusement at home, this is why I leave these things in.
the other thing that you can do a bit of fast advancing with Jinteki.
Yes, you can.
People playing sort of Palana Foods.
Yes, one generally referred to as food coats.
Yeah.
For reasons, I'm not sure.
Is it food coats to do with global food?
I believe so.
Yeah, so you can do various things. There's Harmony MedTech.
Oh God, yeah.
But you only need 6 points to win the game either side. That'll be quicker.
It will be much quicker.
I've played one of those at a tournament.
Was it the Sheffield one?
Yeah,
yeah,
Yeah, I think it was that. Yeah, it confused me because my maths was all wrong.
Yeah.
Yeah, Palana food seems quite interesting. I really like the look of, but I haven't actually managed to use yet. Oh, where's it gone?
Oh, the... is this the magic one that flips?
Yes.
I like flip IDs. This one confuses me.
Jinteki Biotech Life Imagined. There are three different reverse sides to it, and you get to decide before you take your first turn. So you get to see who you're playing.
And then you pick which one you want.
It costs you three clicks to flip the identity.
Yeah.
One choice is the brewery. Do two net damage, which seems to be the most common.
Yep, even though it seems like a massive waste.
A little bit, yeah. The tank, when you flip this identity, shuffle archives into R&D.
Pretty cool.
And the greenhouse, when you flip this identity, place four advancement tokens on a card that can be advanced.
Which to me feels like the better one.
The card has to be there.
Yeah.
Because it's a triple thing. But yeah, you can score a 4-point agenda from flat.
It's not a triple thing if you include biotic labour.
Yeah, you'd probably want to take biotic labour in there. What's quite interesting is you could build a deck that's always going to be the brewery, or a deck that's always going to be the tank. Yeah. Or you could build a deck that lets you look at what your opponent's doing and pick one of the three.
Yeah.
Bit like when you build an Adam deck with his directives.
You could literally, if you don't have any plans for anything using your ID, just go, cool, I am going to start the game, draw a card, flip over and do two damage. You pretty much get first turn, but you only have three cards to do it with.
Like, only if they haven't mulliganed. So you know that two of those cards are going to be good.
Yeah.
If they mulligan, they might draw rubbish.
They might have.
Yeah.
But then they've got...
I'm definitely keeping this. It's amazing. Can't wait for my first turn.
Boom.
Yeah, two of those go away.
Oh, crap. Yeah.
Yeah, it could be fun. I like the look of it. I like it because it's different.
Yes.
A little bit then, we're kind of running out of time, but just a very quick, brief foray into the world of deck building. I just thought we'd just say, what kind of things, if you're playing Jinteki, you've got lots of these different options, these different archetypes, these different ways of playing. What are you probably going to be spending your influence on?
If you're trying to kill people.
Yeah.
And you're using advanceable things.
Yeah.
Cerebral Overwriter.
Yep.
Because it's so good.
Yes, I've got that in my deck. I have landed some juicy brain damage.
Global Foods. Because it's good.
Yeah, yeah, a lot of people, I mean, that's almost...
Standard.
Standard.
Jackson's, because they're standard. I mean, this is nothing exciting at this point.
The idea for... Global Food reduces your agenda density because it's worth three to you and two to the runner.
Yeah.
So if you're playing something where you're not wanting them to steal lots of little agendas, it can be good.
Mm-hmm.
Or if you want to use them as a way of... closing out the game later if you want, because they're worth more to you.
I find Friends in High Places is a card that I like in Jinteki.
Yeah.
Because they have a lot of things that people want to trash.
Yes.
And it's generally just a very good card in this meta because it can let you bring ice back if that's been destroyed.
Yes. Yeah. Friends in High Places is a great card.
For one influence as well.
Yeah. I've been using a lot of Archive Memories to return trash traps to my hand.
Yep.
Or to return neural EMPs to my hand. Yep. Or to return Mushin most often back to my hand. I had a game against, I think it's against you, where I'd played like seven Mushins
in
the game because I just kept bringing them back using various forms of recursion.
Yeah, that was frustrating.
Yeah, good. but you're probably going to be looking for draw. And you're probably going to be looking for economy cards, I would have thought.
I think there's enough economy in neutrals to provide.
Yeah.
For your influence, you might want some good end the run ice if you want to be scoring.
Yeah, yeah.
You might want to... I don't know. All of mine end up being... Friends, Jackson's, Global Foods, and couple of other things, depending.
Yeah.
I think Arc Lockdown's a really nice card to import from HB into Jinteki.
Yes, yeah.
Because you're doing a lot of damage, you put a lot of things in the trash, and so...
Yeah, that's part of the reason... Similar idea, it's why I took Kronos Protocols in my PE deck, because timing those to... get rid of, they've played a couple of count siphons, then they've played down their same old things, and you're thinking, right, you're going to do that again. No, you're not, it's gone away.
This is why I've got a Kronos Protocol and two Arc Lockdowns in my shooty things deck.
Yes. But if you can snipe out their Sentry Breaker,
and then you remove
and then Kronos Protocol it out or Arc Lockdown it out, it goes away.
Then they can't get into that Surfer anymore.
And a lot of people are really liking the Anarch Breakers that play out of Trash. Archives.
Yeah.
Not Archives.
Heap.
Heap. There we go. Big old heap. Don't keep that. That's racist. They're liking those because it allows you to overdraw to find the cards you need. You then put them in your heap and they come out when you need them. It's kind of like they're on standby.
Yeah.
Being able to get rid of all of their paperclips might leave some people unable to break a barrier.
Yep.
In the way the game is currently played.
And that's kind of exactly the plan. And then Swordsman's just in case they've got AIs. And you're there.
Yeah.
Good. Yeah.
I love a Swordsman.
This is
a Lotus Field. As we said that an hour ago.
This is what I'm going to be throwing at you in the pub soon. Cool.
Nice. Okay, so that concludes our thoughts on Jinteki. If you have been playing Jinteki, maybe have a different way of playing Jinteki or an interesting deck that you've been playing, let us know.
Or that we were just horribly wrong about something.
Yeah, if you think we've got something wrong, if there's cards we've discounted that you think are great or cards that we have counted that you think are rubbish, let us know.
Yep.
Because we're going to be doing this as a monthly thing. Next month, we're going to move on to a runner, so we're going to bounce back and forth.
Yeah.
And we'll be putting up a poll on our Facebook page.
We will.
For
exciting
people to vote.
Technology things.
Yeah. So not only do you get to vote on which faction you think we should talk about first, it'll also dictate what faction at least me and Joe are playing, and probably Jamie and Aaron to a certain extent as well, if they're able to join us.
Yeah.
Because we want to give you a full, proper lowdown. Obviously not a comprehensive, this is how you win tournaments with them, but as a beginner's guide and an intro... to those factions, we need to know our shit first as well.
Yeah.
So you'll be dictating our nights down the pub with your choices. So you can pop over to Facebook and find us on there and vote. I'll make sure that goes up the moment that we do this.
Yeah, we're gonna alternate, aren't we?
Yeah. So you'll have a choice. We won't look at the mini factions for Runner because that's kind of three different things we have to play. But you'll have a choice between Shaper, Anarch and Criminal.
Yes.
And we'll save maybe the mini factions for the end. Pop along, tell us what you think we should be playing next, and make sure you give us any feedback. As I said, if there's something that we've missed or something that you think is great or rubbish that we've talked about, please let us know. This has been episode 66. I have been Brian Ennis.
And I've been Joe Lewin.
And we will catch you next time. Don't forget to vote on our poll for which runner faction you want us to do. That's the last thing I wanted to plug.
Yeah, I got really scared for a second because I thought something horrible political was going on and we'd have to deal with another catastrophe.
No, it's fine.
It's okay. It's only what we're doing.
Yes, cool. Don't forget to vote, people. Just in general. Just vote for everything.
We need a picture of the whole we want you thing with one of our...
Do you know what is a good card for Jinteki? Voter intimidation. There we go.
Yes.
So until next time, vote or I'll send round the net damage goons to sort you out. Thank you very much. Catch you next time.